only one I see. V is very, very extraordinary. E is even more than anyone that you adore can love, is all that I can give to you. Love is more than just a game for two. Two in love can make it. Take my heart and please don't break it. Love was made for me and you. Is for the way you look at me. O is for the only one I see. V is very, very extraordinary. E is even more than anyone that you adore can love, is all that I can give to you. Love is more than just a game for two. Two in love can make it. Take my heart and please don't break it. Love was made for me and you. Love was made for me and you. Love was made for me and you.
All right, everybody. Love was made for me and you. Welcome to another live stream from the National Jazz Museum in Harlem. My name is Ryan Maloney. I help with the education and programming here at the museum. We're excited that you're joining us for another episode of Music on the Brain. And this one is an exciting one. Following on the heels of Valentine's Day, we will be looking at love and how love makes the brain go wow. And I just wanted to on behalf of our executive director, Tracy Hyder-Suffern, and our artistic team of Jonathan Batiste and Christian McBride, we welcome you here to our live stream. Many of you have been here before. Those of you who are new, we encourage you to become a member of the National Jazz Museum in Harlem. You can do that on our website, jmih.org. We're getting a new website soon, so that's the first little notification that by April we'll hopefully have a brand new website. But if you want to become a member, you want to learn more about the museum, go to jmih.org or jazzmuseuminharlem.org, and you can check out all that we do at the National Jazz Museum in Harlem. Our programs are presented free online, and a majority of our on-site programming, when we get going on-site, is presented free as well, thanks to our funders, our generous supporters and funders. If you would like to become one of those generous supporters and funders, you can text the word jazz to 41444, or you can make a donation again on our website, jazzmuseuminharlem.org. So we're going to get going with another episode of Music on the Brain. This is a partnership with the Zuckerman Institute over at Columbia University, and we've been doing this program for quite a while now, 2 years maybe, close to it, and it started as a result of the Zuckerman having creating an artist-in-residence program, and the inaugural artist-in-residence for the Zuckerman was the tremendous pianist and composer and band leader and person, Helen Sung. So I'm going to bring Helen out, and we're going to get started on another edition here of Music on the Brain. So welcome, Helen.
Hi, Ryan. Thank you so much. And thank you for the very kind introduction. And thank you to the Zuckerman Institute for having a jazz artist in residence, which is so cool. And in 2020, it's been the wonderful Miguel Zenon, alto saxophonist and composer. And I'm just really pleased and delighted to have something from that residency continue on in my life, because the brain is something that I definitely am very interested and invested in, since it's kind of vital to life and everything that I do. So getting the chance to talk about neuroscience and the neuroscience behind how we experience music, you know, what could be better and more fun? So as we typically do, I like to start with some music. And this is kind of a sad thing from last week. A week ago, one of my heroes of the jazz piano unfortunately left us, the great Chick Corea. So I want to start with something that he wrote that I've arranged for and recorded on one of my previous albums, Anthem for a New Day. This is his Armando's Rumba. And part of my arrangement involves taking the song through different keys. So as you listen, maybe check out how each key sounds might sound different, how it might make you feel a little bit different. And I hope through it all, we feel love for Chick Corea and his incredible legacy. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. And because I just felt like it, and I love sharing the love of jazz music. That's something I so appreciate about this art form, its generosity and its inclusiveness. I have invited a special guest to join me today, and she is a wonderful vocalist who I think, you know, singers can communicate love probably better than, you know, you can't get any better than vocalists, and especially this one. So please welcome to the Zoom screen. Oh, StreamYard screen. I obviously shouldn't talk so much after I just finished a piece like that. But anyway, please welcome the wonderful vocalist, Carolyn Lenhart. Dun, 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 dun. And as Ryan mentioned, we are just a couple of days after Valentine's, and today we are talking about that most mysterious region, human emotions, right? And love is definitely main topic in jazz. So let's do a song about that.
Sure. I'm not sure which one you want to do.
A great tune written by George Gershwin, yes, the Gershwins. It's very clear. Time may go on, oh, my love. to stay.
Yeah, Carolyn Lenhart, thank you so much for that. And of course, we have our very special guest scientist for this month. And before I bring him into the StreamYard window, I want to read something from one of his papers that I read. You know, I like to look through the scientists' research. It's so fascinating. Just the many different things they're studying about the mind and the human brain. And this is related to music because our guest is a bassoonist, now turned neuroscientist, studying the hows and the whys music makes us feel so intensely. So this is quote, "Music does not directly nourish our bodies. It is not a tangible commodity. Throughout history, there have never been threats of music shortage, nor cases of persons becoming addicted or overdosing on music. And yet the enjoyment of music making and music listening has remained an integral aspect of human cultures across time and space." So I would say, you know, like love makes our brains go wow. I think music definitely does too. So I'm so pleased to introduce Dr. Matthew Sachs from the Zuckerman Institute, who will tell you a little bit about himself. Welcome.
Hi, Helen. Hi, Karen. Thanks for having me.
Our pleasure.
So yeah, I can just go over a little bit of my background and how I got into this field. As you said, yeah, I've been a musician for most of my life. I have two parents who are therapists, psychiatrists. So I think the idea of thinking about hard problems through the lens of the mind and the brain kind of came naturally to me. And I remember kind of at a young age being perplexed by my own emotional responses to music and how strong they were and how easy I was able to be transported to different times and places just by listening to songs. And so I kind of just followed that thread throughout my career, and I became more interested in science and the brain and neuroimaging and how we can look at the functioning of the actual brain. And it just seemed natural to me that I would combine those two interests as I moved on. And I was lucky enough that at Harvard, I was able to work with a group of scientists that were already working on a variety of ways in which music changes the structure of the brain, but also the functioning of the brain. And since then, yeah, I haven't really looked back. I've just kind of continued trying to answer the things that are most intriguing to me about the music listening experience.
That's amazing. Do you still play the bassoon? Do you get to, I've heard of doctors having ensembles and orchestras, and maybe the Zuckerman Institute should have something like that.
I haven't played in quite some time. It's hard to maintain. It's definitely like a labor intensive instrument. So I have other little keyboards and things around to keep me occupied, but no, I haven't played the bassoon in a bit.
Okay. Well, gosh, so cool. I just remember as a kid, you know, I played in youth symphony violins, and just now whenever I hear the symphony orchestra, just the texture of the sounds, the strings, the winds, the brass. And Carol and I were talking about this the other day too, how music can make us have a visceral response in our bodies. And I know this is part of your research, and maybe you can tell us a little bit more about that.
Yeah, exactly. So some of my early, kind of the first major study I worked on and conducted was about the experience of chills to music. So you can pull up some of those slides actually now. This might be a good time. So many of you might know exactly what I'm talking about when I say musical chills, but if you don't, the way we typically define it is that kind of tingling, shivering sensation that you can get, not just from music, you can get it from movies, from looking at a beautiful piece of art or nature, but it's very common with music. It's often accompanied by goosebumps, but not necessarily always. And people who experience them to music or to other forms of art usually report it as being occurring at the same time as like a peak enjoyment response or peak pleasurable response. And to me, chills are interesting for two reasons. One is that not everyone gets them. So people will range in the frequency in which they say they get them. Some people have never experienced them, or almost rarely. Some people, I get emails all the time from people based on my research, and some people say they get them violently kind of every single time they hear a particular piece of music. And the other thing that is interesting about it is that it's a very biological response to things that we typically associate with being cold or fear, for example. And so it's a really interesting question why we would have this same reaction to something like music, which isn't cold and isn't usually fear-inducing. And in terms of what happens in the music that is generally associated with chills, it's hard to say. There isn't like a one-to-one mapping between like a sound and a chill and people get, and everyone getting chills. But we know some general things. We know it's generally associated with sudden changes or entrances of new voices or increases of dynamics. This has to do with like anything that kind of surprises us in a way or focuses us in on the music. And I can talk a little bit why these associations are typically, these musical associations typically result in chills. We also know that there's certain people that are more likely to experience chills than other. And there's this one particular personality trait called openness to experience. This is like the ability to seek out new and novel situations. And people who are more likely or more willing to do that tend to also report experiencing chills to music.
Very cool. So musical chills, is it always associated with that term you said, a peak in your enjoyment of the music? Does it ever occur with, have you ever talked with somebody like, oh, I can stand that song? And it's just, is there a associated response with that too? Or
as in, are there people that get chills to songs they dislike?
Yeah. Or, or is it always associated with something positive? I guess that's what I'm saying.
Okay. Well, so the, for the vast majority of people, yes. And it's very unlikely, very, very, very unlikely that someone would get it to a piece of music they hated. Now, there are acoustical sounds, kind of like nails on the chalkboard type sound, that can induce the similar type feeling. We typically don't call that a like chill or frisson or whatever term, and because that's really more about the acoustic elements and not the kind of like peak enjoyment. That's why these things are all not necessary, but part of the experience. That being said, there are people that I said who have told me that it's almost like shaking, kind of like violent chills. And I'm not sure if that experience, I think that is with music that people like, but because of the intensity of the emotional response, I'm not sure that they always are seeking that out or looking to replicate that.
Got it. Okay. Well, I want to put this to experience and see how our audience might participate in this aspect of your research. And we're going to perform another song. We're going to ask Carolyn to sing and pay attention to your body as you listen to this song. What do you notice? Do you notice any chills? We hope you do have a peak in enjoyment. So this song was made famous, I would say probably the most famous version, by Etta James, right? So I'll let the vocalist introduce the song.
I don't know that much more of an introduction is needed, except that Etta James recorded and released it in 1960. So when we think about this song that everyone knows and loves so dearly, and the fact that it's already 81 years old, I feel like that alone brings me chills. At last, my love has come along. My lonely days are over. Yeah.
Wow. So do we have any audience responses, any comments? I know when I am moved by music or hear something like that, when I we were talking about this, and I feel like I associate it, when I get chills, it's when I feel like I'm in the presence, very in contact with the person's spirit, like who they are in their essence, you know? And when Carolyn lets loose like that, like, I mean, it's not just that part, it's all of it, just the intimacy and the being vulnerable like that, I feel this, just this shaking inside, you know? It's like a being in awe, or it's being in a holy place with another human being. So I don't know. Do you want to talk a little? She has some interesting experiences too.
Oh, it's a whole other conversation. No, but I mean, I know what you're saying, and I'm not talking about my singing at all from my perspective, but it is when there's something incredible about feeling like you're seeing directly into someone's soul and the passion of someone's spirit. And I mean, I can mention it, but I since I was a young girl, I had this reaction to people sometimes doing very, very simple movements. Like a babysitter would be reading a book and slowly turning pages, and I would get unbelievable chills in such a powerful way that I would almost go into a trance and have this reaction like, don't ever stop reading the book. Don't ever. And I've had it to friends sitting around a friend's kitchen, of course, back in the day, which is a friend was like slicing cucumbers, you know, and just, there was just such a purity there that it had a reaction like that. And I have it honestly, every time you play to consistently, I mean, every time there's just something so powerful about the purity of it. I don't know if those things are connected, but music on top of that is really incredible. And it's amazing to know this, how quickly you can hear something, a piece of music, and it can just have a complete sea change for your being, for your state of mind, for your just sense of wellness and stuff. It's really amazing. I'll get this back to you.
Oh, thank you, Carolyn. If we have any responses, oh, thanks, Dr. Paula Croxon. Thank you. She definitely got the chills at the end. Lovely. Oh, Ryan, thank you. I'm not sure what ASMR stands for,
yes,
though. Sorry.
Yeah.
Oh, that's what you're talking about?
It is, but I don't even want to say that term because I think suddenly it's gotten really popular and there's a lot of weird stuff on the web about ASMR, and I don't think that relates to what we're talking about and what I experienced. So yeah, technically, I guess, ASMR.
Not surprising in someone who's so artistic and gifted in that way. So cool. Can we bring Dr. Sachs back to the stage and talk about another very interesting part of his research, which I will let him introduce.
Sure. Yeah, that was beautiful. By the way, I also got chills towards the end. Part of that, just to really relate to what you were saying, I will try to put a scientific spin on seeing into someone's soul. I think the idea of social connectedness or understanding another person, where they're coming from, their feelings, bonding in some way, are very important aspects of chills to music or any emotional response to music. And it relates a little bit to this other phenomenon that I tend to study, which is the idea of pleasurable sadness. The idea that the emotion of sadness is something that's beneficial to us or can be powerful or meaningful, but it's not something we often like to seek out, or hopefully not all of us like to seek it out. And really, like, we usually, when we feel sad, we want to move on from it, or we're trying to find ways to actively move on. Yet many of us experience this times when we want to listen to sad music or really enjoy listening to sad music. Same with sad films, for example. And so this is another kind of interesting emotional conundrum that I wanted to study. We can pull up some of those slides as well. I can talk a little bit more about this pleasurable sadness idea. So this is kind of explained best, as most things are, by Peanuts cartoons, where people just have this fixation and desire to keep listening to things that make them more sad. And so we're trying to study this from the lens of the mind and the brain. And there's a couple of things I can talk about that we know. Going to the next slide. Yeah, so actually you can just go to the next one after this. So if we think about how emotions are processed in the brain, or how emotions can trigger different responses in the brain, one way that's very helpful to think about this is that there's a number of different mechanisms by which a piece that you hear can induce an emotional response. And so these can be kind of lower level. If we talk about lower level, we mean like kind of more evolutionarily ancient parts of the brain, more basic functionings that happen really, really quickly. Like if you bang a timpani, for example, I know that's not necessarily considered music, but you're gonna have an emotional, you're gonna have an arousal response, right? So that's one possible mechanism by which music can induce an emotion. And then if you kind of go here from the left to the right, you have these higher order, slower processes that involve more higher order cognition. So one way of thinking about pleasurable sadness is that, let's take like the Adele piece, Hello, or any of her beautiful sad songs. You can hear it and you can kind of resonate with the character or the singer or the performer, and you think, oh, she's conveying sadness and she's conveying this sad story, and I also feel sad because I'm relating to her, I'm hearing her, and I'm kind of empathically understanding who she is. But at the same time, you can have a separable mechanism that's producing a different emotion, such as the realization that the music itself is beautiful, or the realization that, you know, you're not actually experiencing that, but there's something beautiful about connecting with this person. So you can have these two different mechanisms happening at the same time, or around the same time. And this is kind of our best guess of what we think is happening when people are experiencing pleasurable sadness. It's this kind of mixed emotional state based on different mechanisms to the same piece of music.
Can I ask you a quick question?
Sure.
So I remember when we talked earlier, you were saying how in terms of brain activity, it's not that there's one part of the brain that lights up when you are experiencing happiness, or another part for sadness, or another part for fear, and that it's actually the brain working together in tandem. And Carolyn and I were talking earlier how do emotions really exist in singularity anyway, and how there is happiness with sadness. And I don't know if that's part of the pleasurable sadness, or just was wondering about your thoughts about that.
It's a really good question, and whether you know it or not, you're wading into a very fierce debate in neuroscience right now and psychology in general about what is an emotion, and do they exist as categorically distinct objects, or is there just dimensionality to them? And honestly, I don't even know where I come down on it. There's really evidence on both sides. I think the idea that these things are completely separable is a myth, right? Happiness is not completely separable from calmness or joy or even sadness to a certain extent. There's this degradation for sure between them. But it is helpful in terms of our research and in terms of understanding what patterns of brain activity and behavioral activity mean to have these categorical names when we study them. Mm-hmm. And so that, right, it's kind of only helpful so far. It's a really, really tricky question. And what I'm showing here is definitely an oversimplification of exactly what's happening. But this is kind of a framework by which to think about it. And then we can test if the brain activity is mapping onto this framework.
No, that makes sense. I think we need something like this to help us organize our thoughts, at least, or in the research. And then the, experience is always, can be such a mystery and then mm-hmm. a surprise. So if there wasn't anything more you wanted to share in terms of this slides and stuff like that, maybe we can sing a song that's about kind of this pleasurable sadness idea. How about that?
That sounds good. Yeah?
Okay, cool. You want to?
Sure.
Why don't I just, should I say try the lyrics? Yeah. If I can remember them. Sometimes so hard to remember them out of the context of the song. And I don't know why I'm all about the timeline today, but this song happens to be 90 years old, which is just, again, like, I know, it's unbelievable when you think about it. Okay. Beautiful love, you're all a mystery. Beautiful love, what have you done to me? I was contented till you came along, thrilling my soul with your song. Beautiful love, I've roamed your paradise, searching for love, my dream to realize. reaching for heaven, depending on you. Beautiful love, will my dream come true?
Yes. So I'm sorry. I think I neglected to ask these questions. So I'm glad our wizard of Ryan put it up. Did the song bring anything to your minds? Did it make you feel anything, remind you of anything? I know that music and memories are closely tied together. And we've talked about that in past episodes. So feel free to share your comments. Why don't we move on to the next part while we wait for folks. If you want to share, we would love to hear your thoughts. And this is to do with Matthew's current research, which is very interesting, exciting. He calls it emotion dynamics. And I think it kind of is how we were talking about how emotions don't exist in singularity, but they often transition or maybe enfolded on top of each other. So take it away, Matthew.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Most of the work on emotions, whether or not we talk about different categories or dimensions, is mostly focused as kind of like one moment in time. Typically, the studies in neuroscience have been like static images of faces, for example, or maybe it's a short movie or a short music clip. But it's rare that we study the kind of long-term temporal component of emotions, but that's such an integral part of them in everyday life. Like it's rare that, you know, we feel happy or we feel anger, but those transition and change kind of naturally all the time. It's rare that we're kind of feeling something so strongly for like one thing at any given time, right? So the thing that kind of fascinates me now that I've been kind of spending so much time looking into is this idea that what parts of the brain are responsible for the transitions from one state to another. And so in a way of studying that, I thought music was actually kind of an ideal stimulus to do that. If you think about like a symphony, for example, and all the different emotions you might be feeling throughout the entire piece, or even Bohemian Rhapsody or something with the different themes and how it brings you along. Music is kind of a great way of traversing these different emotional planes over time and bringing people along. So we developed these new musical pieces that are naturally designed to kind of carry people along this emotional journey. And the next step is to actually see what happens in people's brains when they're listening to this piece, and not so much looking at the spatial patterns. So where do we see activity, but when? So the temporal patterns, how are different regions, the brain patterns changing over time in response to the emotions that people are feeling and those changing over time.
That is so cool. And you said you purposely enlisted people who specialized in composing for film, which I think is a brilliant idea, since the music there has such a defined role, right? It has to kind of sum up or hit home the whatever visually is going on at that moment. And did you confine the sections to a certain amount of time, or did you leave it up to the composers, or what kind of parameters? Because I think you haven't actually started testing this yet, right? You have it already. We just need to be able
to... I haven't looked at the neural responses. We've looked behaviorally at how people respond.
Oh,
yes.
Okay.
So that's exactly right. We asked film composers because they're particularly adept at being able to convey an emotion in a really short period of time with a lot of constraints. That's exactly what their job is. So when I told them, you know, we need this number of instruments to convey this number of emotions in this amount of time, they didn't bat an eyelash. They were like, okay, great. Whereas if I asked probably, you know, like an avant-garde, like Columbia student who's studying composition, they'd be like, well, no, I'm not, like, I'm not going to sacrifice my art for that or something like that. So it was good for them. They were very familiar with this type of requirements that I had. And so they, so far it looks like when we have people listen to these pieces of music, people are experiencing changes around the times when the composers were intending those changes to occur, which is great.
Amazing. And did you have a limit on how many different types of emotions you were looking for, or?
Yes, we ultimately went with, so it was tough because we wanted them to use basically the same instruments to kind of convey the same tempo and the same instruments to convey these different emotions, which is really tough. As you probably know, when you're playing, tempo is a huge component in how you're trying to convey how you're feeling or maybe how the composer was intended to feel.
Right.
So we ultimately went, we wound up with four or five different emotions that reliably can convey through music that they could reliably convey with those instruments and in that tempo. And so far it's working pretty well. This, we have a dreamy nostalgia theme, which is a little bit more complex, but I mean, I think that's kind of the nature of the emotion itself. People experience that in lots of different ways.
That is really cool. So, well, we have two jazz veterans here. We'll try to convey some emotional transitions and changes. In fact, Carolyn was talking about when she talks to her students, how the song has to take you on a journey. So we're going to kind of do something kind of artificially set up. So I think there's a cool slide with different emotions to, can we pull that one up with the different faces? Yes, emotion dynamics. So we're going to take you through this song, and sometimes the emotion and the, you know, this is a different level, right? You're dealing with instrumental music purely, right? So we have lyrics here too, which adds a little layer of complexity. So sometimes we're going to see if the emotions and the lyrics match up, or they might clash, or they might be a little confusing. And so to the listeners out there, pay attention to your body, to any, you might get, this might be the first time where somebody gets goosebumps like, oh no, they're ruining the song. Or just, you know, any type of visceral response or what emotional feelings or memories you might be experiencing. We would love to hear. So I'll let Carolyn introduce the song because we sing this in her band when we play, and it's, she has a lovely arrangement, but we're not going to do that today because in the interest of science.
Today is an exploratory journey. And I will say, you know what? It's really interesting. I just discovered that this song, which was, I think it was written in 1923, but even more importantly than the date, unfortunately, in my mind now, is that it was originally composed with a different lyric.
Really?
Yeah. And then they took the melody and they changed the lyric. So that even adds a whole other layer on top of this.
Wow. Do you know the original lyric?
I don't. It's on my to-do list. Although maybe we don't know it for a reason. The lyric as it stands seems to me a perfect match to the song. This is Sometimes I'm Happy. Sometimes I'm happy. Sometimes I'm blue. My disposition, it all depends on you. Never mind the rain from the skies if I can find the sun in your eyes. Sometimes I love you. Sometimes I hate you. But when I hate you, it's because I love you. That's how I am.
We got any comments, any observations? Any want to guess what kind of what order of emotions we did that in? Well, let's see. Thank you. Thank you so much. That's a very kind word. Yes, all about feel and feeling. Yes. Anybody else? Well, I don't know. I kind of changed it. Well, I'm curious because we didn't really plan this ahead of time. So I want to ask Carolyn what emotion she was feeling. Like, oh, that's another interesting thing to think about. Like, what in the music exactly might cue whatever it is you're feeling? Is it the rhythm? Is it the touch? Is it the pitch? Is it the key? That's something else I forgot to ask, something that occurred to me over the weekend. So you want to, let's let the vocalist talk about the emotional journey she was on in terms of the one that I made her go on.
Well, whatever happened, I was with you, so we were on it together. Yeah. I will also say that especially this time I was thinking about the fact that I feel like there was one component to it which I wish I could have gotten rid of, and that's my face. Because to whatever extent it was coming through or not, I felt like, well, wait a minute, is my face emoting the emotion, you know, expressing the emotion as well as my voice, maybe even more so. So I'm wondering if that was a part of it. But I will say we didn't have a master plan that I remembered. So I was going with the flow. And I feel like first, you know, you were eliciting in me at least like a very dreamy, ethereal thing. Journey. Yay. And then when you went to the there was sort of a trend. I feel like it was a transitional period where there was more, it was weird because there was more concrete emotion happening, but also that was transitioning. So I don't feel like I emoted with clarity.
Well, that's so awesome because I wasn't sure what I was going to do either. And I was like, should I make this happy? Oh, no, it's too late. The section is over. So that was kind of trying to be more jaunty, a little more rhythmic.
Yeah.
But that's not emotion. I guess more just lively. More.
Yeah.
Okay. So what was after that?
So after that was more. Oh, God, do we go to the minor area? Sorry. Yes. Sorry. Okay. Yeah. So that was... Sorry to cheat.
No.
But it's true. When you started playing in the minor key, that definitely brought out, you know, more negative emotions. So
of course it was at the motion. It was at the moment where she's saying, sometimes I love you. I need to learn the lyrics. Obviously.
But the second line is sometimes I hate you. So that's the point, is like the duality of it. You know, it's all good. I don't know. So that definitely was more, more like in a suffering, painful, angry kind of way. Not that I, but it wasn't, I don't know that it was a very, maybe it got more of a vocal angry thing towards the end of it. And then it sort of went more to a bluesy thing, yeah. which then comes around because obviously blues also expresses that duality, the joy of suffering, and not to minimize or encapsulate anything about the blues. But so it was an interesting journey you took me on, and thank you for taking me for the ride.
Well, thank you for coming with me, and I hope you guys are enjoying her, Carolyn's vocals, as much as I am enjoying accompanying her. And let's bring back Dr. Matthew Sachs, because he has this very cool video that I wanted us to see before we start to wrap things up, where you actually did a visual realization of what's happening in our brains as somebody was listening to a piece by Chopin, one of his nocturnes.
Yeah, that's exactly right. So we can make these pretty cool images to kind of convey to others the dynamic quality of the brain, the thing that we're trying to capture with our research and with our statistical methods. If you can pull up just the image, I'll show you. So this is a particular video, one that we made in the lab. So this is brain data then now being portrayed on this kind of like stock image of a brain of a one person listening to the Chopin Nocturne, as you just said. And what I'm plotting here, so just to orient everyone, We're plotting basically the signal change in the brain, which is the measure we're getting from fMRI at every time point stitched together into a movie. And the where you see blue changes, that means that there is less signal at that moment in time compared to the kind of average signal over the course of the whole piece. And red would be more signal. And the signal, you know, it's kind of a nebulous term. What we believe it means is it has something to do with the functioning of that part of the brain. So that part of the brain is becoming kind of more involved in these moments in music when it's red and less involved when it's blue. And then the only other thing that you need to know is that on the left side of, so the two images on the left going down, those are the temporal sides of your brain, the lateral sides of your brain. So the outside, and the two on the kind of column going down on the right would be the, if you basically split the brain in half, you're looking at the middle of the brain. So the auditory cortex is on these lateral sides, kind of right below that kind of indent. That's the auditory cortex, if you want to pay attention to that part. Right below that, yep.
Oh, can we hear a little bit more about that? That was a little too short. Let's take, that was just like, yeah. Okay, that was a little, okay, cool. Wow, that's beautiful. That's beautiful.
Oh, we can. So, yeah, I think that kind of portrays quite well both two of the things I've been talking about, which is that how much of the brain is involved when we're listening to music, and also how studying it only at a single moment in time misses a lot of information. And that person, the person who was listening to that, I believe she told us after that she cried at that kind of part of the piece that we were just listening to.
Amazing. Gosh, thank you so much for taking time out of your very busy schedule to share your knowledge and wisdom with us. And it's been just a really wonderful experience thinking about emotions and how music is a huge part of the emotions that we feel, how it affects our brains. And I think before we leave you, we'll just send you out with one more song. And the theme of today, you know, somebody made a joke that there's so many jazz standards with the word love in it. They said, what if you put another word in there, like apple or something? It was pretty hilarious, all the different titles. So this is an old standard. What is this thing called? Love. Oh, apple. No, I'm just kidding.
This thing called love, this funny thing called love, just who can solve its mystery? Why should it make a fool of me? I saw you there one wonderful day. You took my heart and threw it away. That's why. What is this thing called love? it's mystery. Why should it make a fool of me? I saw you there one wonderful day. You took my heart and threw it away.
Thank you again so much for joining us for Love Makes the Brain Go Wow. We just send all the love to all of you, and please welcome back our grand master of the ceremonies, Ron Looney.
That was amazing. Thank you guys so much. I always learn so much on these sessions, and an added treat to have you here, Carolyn, and add a really special element to it. So we appreciate you joining us. Dr. Matt Sachs, thank you so much. Zuckerman, thank you guys for bringing this opportunity to the museum all that time ago. Lisa Din and Alyssa Mayers and Paula Croxton over at the Zuckerman. None of this would happen without that incredible team. So they're all behind the scenes making it happen. We really appreciate it. And we do have a date for the next one.
Yes.
Let me pull it up. Or Alyssa, if you happen to have it handy, it is March the, let me see, March 16th. So we hope to see you guys all back again. And again, those of you who are new to the museum, please feel free to explore our website, jmih.org. You can become a member. You can support the museum there if you would like. That goes to support continuing these online programming and eventually back at the actual museum on 129th Street, just off of Malcolm X Boulevard. And just one other heads up, March 16th will help us to kick off Brain Awareness Week. So in addition to digging deep into music, we will be celebrating Brain Awareness Week again. So Helen, thank you. It's always great to have you here.
Thank you
so much for making this happen, Carolyn, and everyone out there. Thank you for joining us. Take care, everybody. Have a great afternoon.